The Mitsubishi Motors Badminton Horse Trials is the world's most prestigious three-day event. Following its cancellation last year due to the extreme wet weather conditions, 2013 has set itself up to be unforgettable. As last year's course was unjumped, many of the fences remain the same as when course designer Hugh Thomas walked the track with Daisy Barclay.
Well, the course this year starts as usual in the main arena, nice straightforward fence to get them going and settle the nerves a little bit. And then out into the countryside, and the next fence is the deer feeder fence too. Again, a big straightforward fence, good big galloping fence to get the horses up in the air and make them realise there's a major competition. There's a little bit of a pull up, almost the only hill on the course really goes up to the Horse Quest Quarry. So it's not a very difficult fence in its own right, but it's to say, right, we're now beginning to get into the meat of it. This is the good old quarry.
It's quite early on in the course, so I'm hoping they've got their horses under control at this stage, because that's a good old drop on the landing side.
It is. The log is a little bit further back from the drop than it has been sometimes in the past. So I think even the horses that jump pretty big will still land on the slope rather than right at the bottom of it. But if they do jump quite big over it, it'll take a lot of riding to be in balance and aiming at the next fence. As I say, this one isn't really, I mean, it's not really narrow by narrow standards, of modern narrow standards, but I just thought by making it a slightly shorter fence, it does just mean you've got to be in control the whole way through.
You have to be pretty disorganised to bypass this one, but it could easily happen early on with some over-enthusiastic competitors, I expect.
Absolutely. And then the third part is very straightforward indeed. I mean, horses always jump uphill very, very easily, and it's a nice log, so I don't think that'll cause anybody any anxiety at all, will it?
I wouldn't have thought so.
They then run down to Huntsman's Close, where we've got a big open oxer with pins in, safety pins, in case a horse hits it very hard, going into the Huntsman's Close. And then the riders will have to pick up a very accurate line to jump a bounce of hedges, followed by one stride to a very sharply angled log. But this is a very technical fence and a real four-star introduction.
This is quite a complex, and there's an awful lot going on here.
Yes, there is. That's sort of straightforward, there's nothing technical about it. You hopefully either jump it or you don't. But here we've got a bounce of brushes and then one stride to the angled log going out. I used the brushes here last year, but it was at the end of the course and there was nothing after it, so it's really a completely different question.
I mean, I can see some quite interesting looking sights over this when horses jump this, because it's a big brush and they're still going to be pretty fresh, and I can see them going pretty airborne over these two.
I think we ought to go and look at this this log going out, actually, because the relationship of that to the bounce, and we've never jumped that with anything near it before, do you know what I mean? We've jumped it once or twice, but always with a long approach where you had tons of time to get organised. One of the things when one's course designing nowadays at the top level, I think we're all moving to try and test the riding as much as the ability of the horse. And I'm always looking to produce unpredictable fences, i.e. fences where a rider cannot be absolutely certain what their horse is going to do. So they then have to adjust instantly and play it by ear a bit, or by the seat of the pants.
Yeah, true test of cross-country riding, that's what we want.
The course runs down past the front of the house and around the back of the trade stands, up to the edge of the lake over the Wadworth Barrels fence, but they'll all be thinking very much about the lake to come, because if there is a centrepiece and probably the best known fence at Badminton, probably the best known fence anywhere in the world actually, is the lake. I'm quite interested to see what you think of this, Daisy. It's a new fence here at the lake. I haven't actually had a fence on this particular slope before, and you can see that it's a biggish fence in, and then a bit of a turn and a combination in the middle.
It's certainly a big piece of timber going in, and you say a bit of a turn, but I think when you've jumped a big fence like that into the water, I think that turn's going to be quite influential, and it's not just one little hedgehog brush thing you've got to get over, it's two, so you've got to make pretty sure you're straight for the first one.
generally, a lot of us are moving away from always having alternatives to every, you know, every fence at a big event. But here, I think this is a true four-star question. I don't think anybody's going to argue with that. It's a really serious one. And so I thought it really sensible to provide an alternative, which involves coming in over that fairly straightforward log. It's still got a decent drop on it, you know, you've got to pay attention to it. And then jumping up a step and out over the willow wave on a bounce stride. I think that is relatively straightforward for badminton, but it will take a lot longer because then they have to do a great big circle in order to jump the Mitsubishi pickup trucks. Away from the lake, we come to the countryside brush fence, a very straightforward galloping fence, probably the biggest fence on the course actually, but I don't think it will cause them any anxiety. And then it's down to the revamped sunken lake. Well, this is the first of the changes from what would have been last year's course. And the actual jumps here form part of the legacy from the London Olympic Games, where they were part of a fence called the Ancient Marketplace. And I was quite pleased to get rid of the curved fences that we'd had here for a few years. Try as we might, the horses always seem to find them quite difficult to judge correctly. These have got a very, very inviting profile, but because it's such a nice fence, I have been able to put it right on the edge of this quite serious drop into the old sunken lane here. And so they have to be quite careful not to go too fast and land in a sprawl, because then they've got to be accurate enough to jump both of the two fences on the way out. I think that'll ride all right, but they've got to get a sensible line through the whole complex. Because there is a big drop here, I have provided an alternative, a perfectly simple post and rails, but one that isn't on the edge of a drop and will take quite a lot longer. And when they still from that jump the same B and C element and then go off down the hill out into the vicarage fields, heading for the farmyard. Away from the sunken lane, we go down to the Rodney Power Products farmyard. Actually, very slightly changed from what they would have jumped last year, but it's the same hay cart which we borrow from Mike Weaver, a farmer in Malmesbury, his old, lovely old hay cart, and then a corner with an alternative of two corners. Next is the Mirage Pond, and a complete new look here, as we've got two hedges on a very acute angle, no fence into the water, but the two hedges going out. This is a completely new idea down here at the Mirage Pond. This, of course, will be full of water by the time the horses come to it. We drain it in order for the boys to be able to dig all this silt out of it. But they'll be running through water here and across the pond. They have to come up this quite narrow channel in order to jump this hedge and then a very acute angle and quite a long stride to the second hedge. So they'll be really need to be exploding their horses and taking them strongly forward up out of the water. From here, the course follows a loop that's completely unchanged from the 2012 version until we get back to, well, really right back to this last quarter of the course. From the Mirage Pond, we jump the footbridge. Straightforward fence, quite big, over the ditch, looks pretty daunting, but should be no problem to a well-schooled horse that's aimed at it in the right place. And then to the Outlander bank. And I think this does look very big. It looks quite daunting as they gallop down to it, and it will take a brave horse and rider to jump this. This, I think, is something completely different here at the Outlander bank. I'm certainly not disclaiming responsibility, but we were down here in September, October, looking around, and I was talking about to Alan Willis, the course builder, about the fact that the log on top was rotting and we were going to have to replace it. And he said, why don't we put the owl hole on top? Thought, well, never been done before, but it certainly looks pretty impressive up there.
It does, and I think a lot of people, this bank's been jumped for quite a long time now, so I think you need to vary the theme a bit. And I think it's going to, I don't know if it'll affect the way people ride it, but it might affect the way horses look at it, because it is quite an eyeful. I think you need to just have a little bit more be a little bit more ready to give it a big kick, actually.
Yes. Not for the faint-hearted.
No. And if they do jump it big, there is good old slope on the far side. You want to make sure you're not going to fall off on landing if it pecks. I think it will be, it'll be quite a ride.
A circle round to the beam, an old fence, although we haven't had it for many years, just a single big beam over a big ditch. And then it's up to the Shogun Hollow. The Shogun Hollow has the usual post and rails out the other side over a big double brush, and several strides later to a second double brush. Well, you've certainly seen this fence here before. We've had a number of things the other side of the hollow, but this fairly traditional, a rail, which again will be mounted on frangible pins. The boxes will have some shrubbery in them to give it a little bit more body, but deliberately this year, no alternative.
And I can sort of understand why you're going down that road, because even though it's your traditional nasty inn, it's a proper coffin fence. You need to have it that nice bouncy canter and not be too quick but punchy. But it's definitely, it seems a lot tamer on the way out, even though they're big box fences. We don't have the accuracy tests which we've had in the past.
Let's just actually walk through here and have a look at the hollow itself and the boxes coming out of them, because I'm asking for a certain amount of quite explosive effort to go up from here to what is a decent sized fence.
It is, and I mean, if they do happen to hang a leg at the first part, you're going to lose your impulsion and probably your distance to this one. So, they could still catch a few people out.
And that's one of the reasons I've put a platform in the middle of the hedges here for the horse that does meet this on a wrong stride, maybe takes off where you're standing or,
good luck.
Or goes right in here. The shooting butt is a very well-established fence out in front of Badminton House. Straightforward, big, should give a very great feel to the riders as the horse flies over this. And they run then down to the table on this gallop in front of the house. The HSBC marketplace, an upright gate, and then again, two corners. On the direct route, it's gate, several strides, corner, bend, and another corner. The longer route has smaller corners and much more space in between them. We go to the staircase. Staircase has been here for many years. I've changed this time the fences at the top. We've had some artificial portable log piles for many years. Now we've got some double brushes up here. And I think, particularly on the direct route, this one will take a lot of jumping. It's really quite narrow. And we'll need a very accurate and very fit horse. Off down to the village near Little Badminton. This is numbered as 3 this year, so that although it's very late on the course, if any horse did stumble or do something odd in between one of them, then riders could circle round rather than have to go straight through the whole complex. They run down to the keeper's brush. Again, a fence that's absolute stalwart, a tradition of Badminton. But it still is a very big ditch and a very big hedge. Up through the copse, just moved a big tree trunk here. It's a very nice tree trunk. I don't think it'll cause them the slightest anxiety, but it just is somewhere where they've got to just find a line. And in particular, they've got to pick up a line away from it to jump the new Rolex crossing made of the two boxes that might contain watches. Finally, into the ring at the Mitsubishi Motors last fence. A very welcome sight for the riders, I'm quite sure, as they swing round through that and into the finish.
And with that, the cross-country phase will be over. Horse and rider will have finished a challenge of nearly 6.5 kilometres in a time of just over 11 minutes. Not all will complete this famous course, but from those that do, one will be on track to becoming Badminton champion.